6-month break was nice and all, but I think it's time to get back to, oh, I remember to forget to do the thing. Tokyo Mirage Session Sharp FE, a JRPG on the Wii U that came out in 2016. It's really hard to talk about the game without knowing its background. So back in 2013, during a Nintendo Direct, it was announced that there was going to be a game that was going to be a crossover of Shin Megami Tensei and Fire Emblem. This game caught my attention when it was announced, me being a big fan of Fire Emblem, but unfamiliar with Shin Megami Tensei. Although at the time, Shin Megami Tensei 4 was coming out on the 3DS, so I decided to give the series a look because of it, and long story short, I fell in love with the game and it got me into the SMT series. So now being a big fan of Shin Megami Tensei, and already being a big fan of Fire Emblem, it got me really excited for Shin Megami Tensei x Fire Emblem. But alas, nothing was heard of the game, with many thinking the game was cancelled. But on April 1st, 2015, the game saw the live day again. Only it wasn't Shin Megami Tensei or Fire Emblem. Even with the reveal of the game being really disappointing, I still had high hopes for the game. Even if it wasn't the crossover game I, along with many other people, were hoping for, it'll still probably be a good game, right? Well, the game came out and, well, I think it's better to talk about the game one piece at a time, and the best place to start would probably be the beginning of the game. So the game starts with an opera, with everyone disappearing due to a fade to black, except for the main female lead. But that doesn't really matter too much since the game does a 5-year time skip, and the girl is now in high school, and also has dreams of becoming an idol. The main character just happens to stumble upon her before an audition, and during the audition the girl gets dragged into another world,
despite the fact that wasn't really possible 5 years ago.
And then everyone gets really depressed, except for the main character for some reason. So the main character enters another world called the Idolosphere, which the game really never explains anything about the Idolosphere, other than the fact that monsters live there. And while being there, the main character finds a Dementor, and then he uses a Rishangan on the Dementor, and they become friends, and then he does it again. And after becoming friends of the Dementors, Tsubasa and the main character gain the ability to transform and fight the other Dementors, which are called Mirages. So I guess now's a good time to talk about the battle system. The battle system is based off the Persona games, seeing how each side doesn't take turns to perform an action, but rather actions are ordered based off speed. Just like the SMT and Persona games, you can exploit enemy weaknesses by hitting them with different elements. This will activate something called a session attack, where your teammates can do a follow-up attack by having the right session skill. For example, if you want Tsubasa to follow up from a sword element skill, you'll need the skill Sword Lunge, and then another character might do a follow-up of something like Lance Blizzard. You can also get extra items and money if you have a session combo of 2 or higher. Although that said, when you are able to get a lot of characters to do a follow-up attack with session attacks, it can get boring to sit through since you have to watch all their animations each time. And there's no way to skip it, so it really makes combat kind of slow. I'll go more over the combat later when certain things are introduced into the game. So they run into the boss, but before you get to fight the boss, a friend of the two main characters walks in, and he also has the same power as them. And then it starts the boss fight, which introduces the weapon triangle from the Fire Emblem games, where swords beat axe, axe beats lance, and lance beats sword. The boss is a sword user, despite the fact that his weapon doesn't look like a sword. And Tsubasa and the friend are lance users, which design is a good idea to introduce players into the weapon triangle. There is a problem that comes out of this. The game will not give you an axe user until you complete half of the game, so you really have no way to counter lances for half of the game. What's even weird is the friend character could have just as easily been a fighter or something to finish off the weapon triangle, giving off his personality. Going back to the boss, he's very basic and not hard at all, which does make sense for the first boss. He does have one gimmick, however. When he's halfway dead, he'll replace himself with 3 slimes, and you have to figure out which of the slimes is the boss. Other than that, you really shouldn't have any problems with this boss. So after you beat the boss, you'll meet up with a lady who wants you to join her because of your powers, and you decide to go along with it. It also turns out that only really talented people can transform using mirages, so the lady also wants to turn you and Tsubasa into singers. Tsubasa agrees to this in hopes of finding her sister who went missing during the opera 5 years ago. So the lady brings you to their HQ, where you get to meet Tiki, who literally lives inside a closet and is not able to leave. It turns out that her and the mirages that joined you can't remember anything. Even though Tiki has no memories, she knows how to fuse other mirages into your mirages to make new weapons. This may sound like fusion from the other SMT games, but it's really nothing like that. Basically how it works is you gather material X and material Y, and then you forge into a new weapon. But the weapons are more than just a stat boost, since the game kinda lacks armor. But that aside, weapons also allow your characters to learn more skills. I do like this idea of learning skills from weapons, especially when there's a DLC that allows your players to grind as much EXP as they desire. But since you have to get the materials from enemies, you won't be able to get new weapons from just using the DLC to grind levels. So because of that, relying too much on the DLC actually makes the game more difficult, which I really do like that design choice. After you're done talking of Tiki, the main character and Tsubasa begin training to become singers, only for both of them to suck. This is also where you get to meet Barry. Tsubasa is depressed from being a terrible singer, You then run into a famous pop idol, Kira, who Tsubasa worships. So she gives advice on how to become a better singer to the main character, with Tsubasa never being told this advice, and then she invites you and Tsubasa to her concert, and the concert inspires Tsubasa. It then suddenly gets dark during the concert and everyone gets depressed. And a girl in red robes also shows up, who turns out to be Tsubasa's sister. You then chase after her, which starts the first real dungeon of the game. The dungeon takes place in the Idolosphere within the 106 building, based off the 109 building, so the dungeon has a theme surrounding clothes. You crawl through dress leaves to reach other ends of the dungeon, along with adjusting the poses of the dresses to reach new areas. The dress crawling puzzle is easy, which is understandable for the first dungeon, but it gets really boring after you do it the first time. This is also where you first encounter savage enemies, which are stronger sets of enemies that are scaled accordingly to the level of your characters. In all honesty, if anything is going to kill you in this game, it's the savage enemies. They are easily the toughest enemies you'll fight. Also, something to note with enemies is the fact that you can knock them down while exploring dungeons, which might give you the first turn if the game feels like it.
I mean, it's kind of random most of the time.
You can also go around knocking down enemies if you don't feel like fighting them, which is really nice to be able to avoid enemies so easily. Savage enemies cannot be knocked down, so more than likely you'll end up going into battles with them. If they're too strong, you better hope you can run away. You end up catching up with Tsubasa's sister, and her true feelings are revealed in Persona 4 fashion.
Because we didn't have enough Persona in our SMT crossover game.
She feels that she's not fit to be an idol, when girls are supposedly better are dropping out, and thinks that she has no talent no matter how hard she works. So after a mini-boss fight, Tsubasa feels inspired once more, and it awakens her performa. And here's probably one of the dumbest things in this game. So what you have to do then is leave the dungeon, go to Fortuna Entertainment, go to the Bloom Palace, talk to Tiki, unlock Radiant skills from Tiki, and then go back to where you were in the dungeon and continue on. And you pretty much do this for almost every single dungeon. When the game wants you to do this, it feels like a waste of time. Not to mention, you'll encounter at least 5 loading screens due to this whole thing. And let me tell you, the load times in this game, they can take a while. Touching on what Radiant skills are, they're skills that characters can learn through side stories and stage ranks. They don't take up skill slots. The skills you'll get are passive and they can do many different things, such as raising a character's HP by 10%, resisting things such as poison, and gaining SP skills. Over the course of the game, a character's stage rank will increase, with it going up to 20, although I'm not sure what really makes it go up, it just kind of happens. If you're wondering what SP skills are, they're basically skills that allow an automatic session if it's offensive, or a really good supportive skill, most of the time. So after Tsubasa gains the required Radiant skill,
and after you do the rest of the dungeon,
Tsubasa begins to sing to her sister, because Tsubasa remembers how she used to sing of her sister, and she instantly learns how to sing better, breaking the mind control placed on Tsubasa's sister, which turns out to be a mirage and the boss of this dungeon. The boss battle takes place in the real world, which leaves me with questions. Can mirages exist in the real world? If so, why can't the mirages pair with the playable cast appear in the real world? And since they can't appear in the real world, how are they able to get into their carnage forms? And if mirages can enter the real world, how come no one ever finds out about any of this? Anyway, the boss of this dungeon has no real gimmick, but she can use a pretty nasty debuff spell, along with having 3 offensive skills, with each of them being something a party member is weak to. While not having gimmick like most bosses in the game, she does a good job at introducing players into a more SMT-style battle where buffs and debuffs can really change the tide of battle, along with taking a character's weakness into consideration, especially when enemies can perform a session attack on your characters when hit by something they're weak to. It's not hard, but it keeps newcomers on their toes. After beating the boss, Tsubasa's sister is now saved, and becomes a secretary at Fortuna Entertainment. And the game just kind of forgets about her, despite being a bit of a plot point up until this point in the game. Also, Kira joins your team. Now, Kira is a dark mage that can use dark magic, and I guess this is a good point to talk about light and dark magic in this game. Now, dark and light magic in SMT games worked as insta-kills, but in this game they decided to make them mostly status elements, with a couple drain spells for each element, and 3 offensive spells between the 2 elements. Nosferatu and Naga for light magic, and Flux for dark magic. There aren't any session skills for light and dark magic, so you aren't able to have your other characters follow up from dark or light magic. So in comparison to the other elements, light and dark magic failed to compare since they really don't deal as much damage as the other elements, and the status elements are only useful if the enemy is weak to the element of a status inflicting spell, since the hit rate is low and you'll almost never be in a situation where status element spells would be useful. Between these 2 elements, the most useful spell you could use would be spirit draining spells, since they restore EP, and if an enemy is weak to light magic, it pretty much drains all their EP, making them unable to use skills, which is very nice. Other than that, light and dark magic is pretty worthless and really doesn't need to exist in the game. Now that the day's been saved, it brings the first chapter to a close, which the game introduces intermissions. Intermissions are a period between chapters that let you do whatever, really. Although there's nothing stopping you from doing anything you can do within an intermission when you're in one of the main chapters. The game also introduces side stories, which are pretty much just side stories for every member of Fortuna Entertainment.
Except Tsubasa's sister.
Doing these will grant you new passive skills and something called ad-libs, which is a special skill that a character can trigger randomly in combat. as in the skills just kind of happen whenever the game feels like it.
There are three side stories for each character, with said characters being the following: a clumsy while kind-hearted girl, hot-headed shonen protagonist, cold girl with a hidden cute side,
Hollywood,
Tsundere,
try-hard loli, that guy, drunk bimbo, cringy anime fan, and after the intermission, the game goes into Chapter 2, and there's hardly any reason to talk about it, other than the whole censorship issues that went into Chapter 2. Well, yes, the story is really something not to be taken seriously,
which kind of makes me dumb for questioning it,
but the next three chapters of the game pretty much do what the first chapter does. Tsubasa sucks at something. Fren is taken by Mirage. Tsubasa is inspired to do better. Leave dungeon. Learn skill. Go back. Free Fren Mirage. Boss battle. And Tsubasa gets good at thing.
There, I just spoiled 2/3 of the entire game. You're welcome.
Instead of being a broken record, I'm going to spare you the story for the next three chapters, since it's pretty much just that. So instead, I'm going to focus more on the dungeons and the bosses on the next three chapters. The second dungeon has a theme based around cameras, there being cameras placed around the dungeon. If you step in front of a camera, you'll be sent back to the beginning of a room. Each room is small enough to where it doesn't become too annoying, but there are some parts in the dungeon where you have to jump off these ledges, with multiple places to jump off from. But if you jump off the wrong ledge, you're forced to step into a camera line sight. It's a bit of a guess on which one's the right one, so it's all about that trial and error gameplay. Yay. The boss really isn't anything special. He's probably the first boss to get two actions a turn, and his gimmick is just wasting a turn to summon enemies.
Which really doesn't sound like a gimmick, but seeing how every boss, including the one before, could summon enemies without wasting a turn.
And then have the enemies take hits for him. And then...
Hollywood.
You get this archer character, and is also probably the character that I've used the least. The third dungeon is based off theater, so it looks like a stage for a play. The dungeon starts you off by lighting torches. Nothing really to say about it. But the rest of the dungeon will have you talking to NPCs, and try to light torches the right amount of torches in their room only, or a set amount of torches that can be lit at once. This puzzle does make you think a little, but it's overall really boring since you're just going back and forth to the same locations. The boss of this dungeon is a knight of a large group of enemies. The knight will take the hits for the enemies, so you really can't deal with them too much. Unless of course you use a skill that hits all enemies. The knight has a really powerful attack that you'll use every three turns, so you'd want to prepare for the hit. Or you can just throw down a physical mirror since the game actually sells such broken items. There's a reason the other SMT games don't allow you to buy them, including Persona. In fact, it's even possible to kill the knight before he even gets to use that powerful attack. And then this little girl joins you. What she really excels at is taking physical hits. And she can also try to heal you, but she's really bad at that part, seeing how she has like no magic. And she's also an axe user for some reason, despite being a knight, and knights use lances in the Fire Emblem games.
And I think this goes back to my earlier complaint with the third party member being a lance user.
Since you can easily just make that guy a fighter or something and make the knight a lance user. But no. The fourth dungeon is based around filming. There's 10 doors within an area, with a room before it that tells you which rooms that you can go into.
So you better get that pen and paper ready.
There's also this tile puzzle. It really sucks. Now the boss of this dungeon changes his element every few turns, and lights up different colors to the corresponding elements. He also has this one guy that's helping him in the fight who's kind of there. He really doesn't cause too many problems, and attacking him just causes the boss to heal himself and the extra guy, so you literally just ignore the guy. Near the end of the battle, he'll change his element again, but this time he won't light up, completely changing things since you don't know what his weakness is. In fact, I don't even know if the boss has a weakness at that point. I just use this skill called Empty Wave to negate all of his resistances. And then I just use a magic mirror, since the boss will just use magic that hits everyone at that point in the fight, so I can reflect that and deal triple damage. Oh, and that one guy that was helping the boss in that battle will join you. I really can't recall why he joins you, or why he decided to fight you. And at this point, the real story of the game starts. Well, sort of. It turns out that the Mirages based off the Fire Emblem characters come from another world! Shocker! Then there's this thing called the Cosmic Egg that shows up, which is something that's appeared in a couple SMT games. But the entrance to the Cosmic Egg seems to be blocked off. So here comes the really exciting part of this chapter. You get to go back to all the previous dungeons, and go through them all over again! Well, except the dungeon from Chapter 2 in the prologue. Other than that, you're going back to every dungeon.
And I think there's something about a doppelganger or something, making somebody look bad?
Anyway, you do all that and fight some unremarkable mini-bosses, and then you fight the doppelganger. The doppelganger boss is so bland, I'm not even gonna bother talking about it. And then you go back to the Cosmic Egg. It turns out that this guy was the villain the whole time. You know, that guy. Okay, so this guy first shows up within the first chapter inside a dungeon, and I guess you help him out?
He shows up every now and then throughout the game, kind of treating him like an important character while serving no purpose to the story. So it's obvious that he's going to be the villain as soon as you meet him, seeing how the game goes out of its way to explain who this character is, even though he contributes nothing to the story. That aside, this Mirage is Garnith, and Garnith wants to awaken the Shadow Dragon Medeus.
Just like Fire Emblem.
And then the chapter ends there. So then the final chapter of the game starts, and Tiki wants to train you in order to get ready for Medeas, along with being able to perform the Opera of Light. So you fight some bosses, but Garnith tries to stop you at the end. And may I say this boss was actually a bit challenging? The game was pretty easy up to this point, and the only thing that ever killed me were the savage enemies. Garnith actually made me think and prepare for this boss fight, with what weapons I needed to bring and who I should bring to the fight. And I just enjoyed this boss fight since I actually had to do all that, and it was actually kind of fun setting everything up, along with figuring out the best way to beat him. Okay, so apparently after writing the script, I did kind of talk about the difficulty of this game with other people, and apparently a lot of people find Garnith to be one of the easier bosses. And thinking back, I did skip a lot of random encounters within chapter 5 and 6, so I think he was only really difficult for me since I was really underleveled, possibly. So what Garnith will do is, he'll summon spirits that'll take forms of the different weapons from the weapon triangle. He can also buff them, which can really hurt if someone isn't resistant to that element. Plus, spirits can really hammer the damage onto somebody through session attacks. Garnith can also hit you with something that can drain your EP each turn, which is something since you'll pretty much never run out of EP at this point in the game. Honestly, I don't think Garnith is really all that hard, but he does throw some curveballs at you that really makes you plan things out. So after the boss fight, Medeas awakens. So now is the time to enter the Cosmic Egg. This dungeon has a lot of elevator and warp puzzles, which is now giving me really bad flashbacks of some other elevator puzzles within a Fire Emblem game. And there's also a boss rush to go along with it. So after the final dungeon is done existing, you encounter Medeas, and then he kills the main character during the Opera of Light. So, aside from that laser animation looking really cheesy, along with Medeas also looking really goofy, the main character is brought back by the power of friendship. And Marth. And then what comes after just might be the worst and the best thing to ever happen within the Fire Emblem series. Okay, so the main character turns into Super Saiyan Marth, and then flies off while singing a musical number based off the Fire Emblem theme song. Well, this is really stupid and, well, just bad. I also find this moment to be really funny, although I was really bored out of my mind when I got there, so it's probably really entertaining because of that. It also reminds me of the commercial for the first Fire Emblem game, where it was an opera, with the lyrics telling you how to play the game. Now, the gimmick surrounding Medeas,
other than looking really silly,
is he'll sometimes use a really powerful attack that hits everyone sometimes, but you can use Tiki to negate all attacks for one turn. It'll cost SP to use, so you just can't spam it, so you need to think carefully on when to use it. I think he'll use the really powerful move every 3 turns. But I really wasn't paying attention, so I don't know. Honestly, I just kind of winged it, and just used Dekunda every time Medeas used Dark Breath. So after you beat him, he has a second phase. It's not that much different from the first phase, other than he's weaker to a lot more things now, and he gets some new attacks. Mainly this one where he reenacts his favorite scene from Sonic Adventure. Because of the two phases, the battle against Medeas kind of drags on. After you beat him a second time, all the Mirages go back to their own world, and the main character becomes the president of Fortana Entertainment, because despite having a power that only really talented people could use, the main character really has no talent, other than being a leader and overall a merry stew. Well, that is if you get the true ending, which requires you to do all the side missions, which you'll more than likely do already, since the game really encourages you to do those. While TMS really doesn't look like a Shin Megami Tensei or a Fire Emblem game on the surface, it does share a lot of elements from both the Fire Emblem and the Shin Megami Tensei series. However, the story hardly resembles the source material, with only the last couple of chapters feeling like a crossover between the two franchises. The gameplay mostly centers around the SMT side, having elements from Fire Emblem, mostly in terms of physical elements as an attempt to put the weapon triangle into the game. The gameplay is good, but what really ruins any enjoyment I could have in battles is the fact that battles are so slow in this game. There's attack animations that can go on for over a minute, and only ad-libs, specials, and dual arts can be skipped. Everything else, including the long animations some bosses can have, are unskippable. To complement the boredom of waiting within nearly every battle, the game is also laughably easy, partly to do with the busted skills the game keeps giving you, and also buyable mirrors. It kind of breaks the game. Graphically, the game looks really good, although the models tend to have some odd animations and facial expressions here and there, but still overall looks really colorful and detailed.
Which might be why the load times take so long.
Although the enemies in the game are pretty forgettable in appearance. The music in this game is also bland and forgettable, with the exception of the J-pop tracks, which all sound really good for the most part. Also to note are the characters within this game don't seem to go beyond the anime tropes they're based off of, making them very uninteresting and generic. Overall, the biggest sin Tokyo Mirage Session commits is just being boring. The game isn't really bad, but it really isn't good either. While the game was difficult to sit through for me, the game has an overall positive reception. Because of that, I can't really say this would be something you wouldn't enjoy. Even with that said, I do think it's unfair to judge the game just for being different from the franchises it's based off of. I'd say if you enjoy something like Persona 4, you'd more likely enjoy TMS. And with that said, I can assure myself that I never have to play this game again.